said? Thumbs down, that's all. Well, hey, like I've said before, we're kind of embarrassing on. Kind of a few day journey. I don't know if you guys know or not, but Easter is just like 3 Sundays from today away. It just like kind of snuck up on us, you know. Last year it was in the month of March, so we were embarking upon that this month last year. We have kind of, CJ, would you mind going back to that? Well, going back to the other picture. Wanted to surprise people with that picture, so. So anyway, wanted to let you know that we have celebrated a year anniversary of Harvest Church, and with that year anniversary Thursday, it's the second time that we've had kind of a passerby or come into our service and give their lives to the Lord. Bob and John was there, Darla was there, it was just a really, CJ was there, Carrie was there, just so that you know that I'm not making up these stories, that this stuff actually happens, and it's just really neat. The most organic thing, I have to tell you this story, this is not even part of the sermon, because I just have to share with you what happened. One of the most organic come to Jesus moments that I personally have experienced in my life happened Thursday. And kind of what had happened was that Amanda was her name. Amanda comes and Drew and Veronica had kind of come alongside of Amanda and kind of supported her and lifted her up all week long. And she decides that she wants to come to church. And she tells them, I've never been to church before in my life. I don't really know what it's like. And I'm kind of hesitant about that. And so we have a powerful worship service, and we have a moment in time in which the word is shared and spoken. And at the end of the service, we have communion. We break bread with one another. And I don't notice, but Amanda decides that she's going to just kind of sit where she's at and kind of observe. And she just kind of defers from taking communion. And after our communion on Thursday nights, what we normally do is kind of do a setting where we say, anybody have an aha moment? That sounds familiar, doesn't it? Anybody want to just share kind of what God is speaking on their hearts? And right before that I start saying that, I notice that Amanda's hand is already being raised. And so I'm just thinking, okay, what are we getting into here? And so I was like, yes, Amanda, did you have an aha moment? She says, I didn't take communion. I said, okay. She says, the reason why that I didn't take communion is because I've never been to church before and I've never given my heart to the Lord. And I said, Amanda, would you like to do that today? And she says, I absolutely would. And so I said, come on up here. And Amanda comes up there and the entire congregation prays a prayer of forgiveness and kind of the sinner's prayer. And you know, there's joy and dancing in the streets. And then I ask if there's anybody else that has an aha moment, and nobody can really top that moment, you know? And so it's just really, really great. So after that, I get an opportunity to serve Amanda communion. It's the first time that she's in church, first time that she gives her life to the Lord, first time that she gets to experience breaking communion and bread. And it's just a really great, joyous occasion. And we had 25 people in attendance, and a lot of them are the people that go to the Harvest Church now. And another part of that is that in on the front row is a dad and a son that used to go to that facility called the Church of God. And he stands up after Amanda gives her life to the Lord. Trevor stands up and he says, I am just so thankful that there are so many people in this facility today. And so Harvest Church is doing some great things, you know. I'm just so excited about the momentum that we've had since that we've got this new facility here. We're like 2.5 months into that, and we're seeing a great attendance, you know, for a new start church. Like I told you before, we've got a senior that comes by himself, and he sits next to a couple of people that are kind of, you know, in their 20s and stuff like that. And he's there whether or not that they're there or not. But he's like keeping them accountable too. He says, would you come to church with me? And so, and then we had a new couple that sat in the back row. Their name is Justin and Kendra. So if you know a Justin and Kendra from O'Keen, They tried us out Thursday night, and so we just continue to have great things that happen with that. Praise the Lord, right? Yeah. I'm excited about that. So you ready to dive into it? I mean, just kind of want to tell you some good news, because we're kind of going into a scene, obviously. Whenever you see a picture on your bulletin, you see Jesus kind of laying prostrate on the ground. And you kind of know that you're kind of going into a scenario or a scene that's really heavy. And if we're talking about Jesus agonizing in the Garden of Gethsemane, there's not a lot of bright colors that can be brought out into this image. There's not a lot of bright colors or even bright, happy moments that a person can even preach out of this passage of Scripture. And it's found in Matthew chapter 26. So if you would, turn there with me, and we're going to kind of dive into this scene where Jesus is agonizing. He's coming to this realization that the time that has come, coming to this understanding in which that his hour is about up. Matthew chapter 26. And I'm going to start with verse 36. That kind of rolls off the tongue a little bit, doesn't it? Matthew 26, 36. Matthew chapter 26, starting with verse 36, and it says this. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. He said to his disciples, "Stay here. Stay here while I go and pray over there." When he took Peter and Zebedee and two sons, he began to feel sad and anxious. He said to them, "I'm very sad, as if that I'm dying. Stay here and keep alert with me." And then he went a short distance further, and he fell on his face and he prayed, "My Father, if it's possible, take this cup of suffering away from me. However, not what I want, but what you want." He came back to the disciples and found them sleeping. He said, "Peter, couldn't you stay alert 1 hour with me? Stay alert. Pray so that you won't give in to a temptation. The spirit is eager, but the flesh is weak." The second time he went away and prayed, "My Father, if it's not possible that this cup be taken away unless I drink it, then let it be what you want." Again, he came back and found them sleeping. Their eyes were heavy with sleep. He didn't say a word to them this time. He left them and again went and prayed the same words a third time. He came to his disciples and said to them, "Will you sleep and rest all night? Look, the time has come for the human one to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let's go. Look, here comes my betrayer." And this is God's word for us today. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much for your precious word. We thank you that it is alive and well. And though we know that we've maybe heard the story about you agonizing, God, I pray that as we read and we dive into your word, I pray that it reads and dives into us, God. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen and amen. They could tell that something was different. They could tell that something was different not only about Jesus, but they could tell there was something different about this night. I mean, it was kind of heavy and gloomy, and the darkness was a little bit darker than what it once was. You know, it wasn't the first time that they've ever went into the darkness after the sun has gone down for Jesus to go and pray. Let alone, it's not the first time that they've ever went through this garden to pray. But he could tell that there was something different about this night. There was something different about the night because the darkness seemed darker. It seemed like the mist was heavy, and it seemed like that the situation just seemed to be, words fail me, it's different. And not only did the night seem different, their leaders seemed different as well. Jesus seemed to be just a little bit different. It's not like they've ever seen him. They hadn't ever seen him this anxious before. We've seen him upset. We've seen him upset as he goes through the temple yards, and he's throwing over tables. We've seen him upset whenever he's faced demonic forces and he tells them to leave and they bow their knee and they leave. We've seen him anxious and saddened whenever the news of Lazarus, his best friend, passing away. We've seen him. We've seen him saddened by that. But it seems like it's a little different tonight. It seems like his sadness is a little bit different. It seems like the situation is a little bit different. We've been kind of doing this Bible study on Wednesday nights, and there really wasn't a lot of planning of how that this would. Did I say Wednesday nights? Wednesday mornings is really what I meant to say, whatever I said before. I meant Wednesday mornings at 10 a.m. We gathered in this room, and we've decided that we were going to kind of dive in and see, what does it look like to actually read and study God's Word? How does that look like? How does that apply to our lives? And kind of, we couldn't help but to start at the very beginning of Genesis. And then in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, eventually we're going to get out of Genesis. Eventually we're going to get into another book of the Bible. And I get to thinking, what happens if we get to the book of Leviticus? What happens if we get into the book of Numbers? You know, how can I keep this interesting? And so the other day I was kind of looking through the book of Leviticus and kind of all these different things that are happening. And here are these sacrifices that people had to give back then. And the sacrifices were this. There's the sin offering. There's the guilt offering. And there's something to do with the actual grain offering and all these different types of offerings that has to be given for the forgiveness of the sin. And you want to know something that is very, 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 very interesting to me, just because of the content of what I'm speaking on today, is that almost each and every time that there was an offering given, whether it be doves, whether it be goats, whether it be cattle, whether it be grain or whatever it might be, each and every time, there was another element that was offered in that with the ceremony. And it was olive oil. Olive oil was to help to burn the offerings. Olive oil was help to consecrate the offerings. And I can't help but to notice that whenever Jesus goes into this garden, and his disciples go into this garden, they're in this grove of olive trees. This ancient grove of olive trees that have been there for almost hundreds of years. And in this garden, where all these olives that have been harvested for hundreds of years, I can't help but to think that these olives were harvested for hundreds of years, even before that, to help out with the grain offerings, with the sacrificial offerings. And it was called the Garden of Eden, or I'm sorry, Garden of Gethsemane. And it was called the Garden of Gethsemane for a reason, because this is what it was, literally means. It means to be pressed. So the Garden of Gethsemane, he's praying in this Garden of Gethsemane called this Garden of Pressure. Oppression, or being pressed, because that's what they did with the olives. In order to kind of get the olive oil out of them, there had to be some type of pressure. So as Jesus is agonizing in this olive garden called press, you can't help but to notice that Jesus is pressed. Jesus is in the garden of pressed, and he is pressed. If there's irony ever spoken, that's it. I don't think that's by chance happening that's happening. So he comes into the garden. He leaves some of his disciples and he brings a little bit, some even further. And he stops them right here. He says, you stay here. These other guys are going to stay back here just to keep watch. You guys are going to stay here and pray. I'm going to go just a little bit further. I'm going to go a little bit further into the garden. And as he begins to pray, he agonizes. There's not words in our English language that really make sense. I mean, can we really grasp or make sense to say Jesus is, some of your, maybe if you guys pull out your Bibles or something like that, maybe you guys can help me, because I think that these different translations really do help. You know, some of us say that it seems as if that he is stressed. I am full of anxiety. What What are some other descriptive words that you might have? Throw them at me.
Overwhelmed.
With what?
Sorrow.
With sorrow. I mean, really, the Greek, and we're not going to have a Greek Greek study word or anything like that.
Epiphany.
But ultimately, here another one.
Epiphany.
Epiphany? Sorry, is that what you said?
A realize of a sudden realization.
Okay, yes?
Maybe.
So there are different words about that Jesus is using to describe the way that he feels upon that. He says, I'm very sad. It's as if that I am dying. There's really, in the Greek language, trying to translate it into English language, obviously there is a mix-up in communication here. Not really a mix-up, but there's really not one word to describe what Jesus is feeling right here. In the context of this conversation, he literally says, I feel pain. Literally, I am paining. Another situation is whenever he says that I am paining, it's another connotation in which that they use, another word in which they use in childbirth. It's as if, the only way that I can kind of relate to it is this. I've had a kidney stone before that's been lodged somewhere in between passing and not passing. We've talked about this before a couple of weeks ago with some people. We took some kids to Six Flags, and I remember after riding Mr. Freeze was the last ride that we rode upon. And I remember that the park was closing, and we go into the van, and I get in the van, and I drive to. Were you there that night, Tiffany? You didn't go to Six Flags with us. We ended up going to a convenience store. I remember stepping out of the van, and I don't know if the step out of the van dislodged a stone or if it was Mr. Freeze. I blame Mr. Freeze. But I can remember as soon as I stepped out of the van, I started rolling on the pavement. And everybody was like, what is wrong with Kaysen? And I was like, oh. You know, it was almost like that there was a pressure that I could not relieve, no amount of movement or anything like that, and they thought something was wrong with Kaysen. I can't help but to think that whenever Jesus is saying, I can't help but to think that I'm dying, that's the best way that I can relate to that. That emotionally, so much emotionally pain was being pressed upon Jesus. And I get this imagery that in other translations, that this type of pressure and stress that pressed down upon Jesus, that he literally begins to sweat blood. The stress, the pressure is so much for Jesus that he, as if that he is dying. I am paining. In the same sentence, he uses another word that describes his distress. It's a verb. It's not an adjective here. That's why that I think that it's kind of difficult in our English language. It's a verb. I am stressing. I'm not stressed. It's me. I am stressing. That's who I am. And that's kind of what was happening here with Jesus. He's saying, I am stressing. That's who I am. The last words of Jesus to describe his own kind of state of being in the scene is a word for sorrow or grief. And it carries the connotation is that no scene in any type of movie could possibly reiterate what's going on. And Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane, and the eight disciples are here, and he is praying. And nobody can stay awake. And he is distressing. And he is paining. And there has been this amount of grief that is being pressing upon him. Have you ever felt that type of grief before? There's not a lot. It's kind of sad that me personally, I've felt that way through the eyes of others. I know one day that there's probably going to be a day in which that feeling is going to be placed upon me personally. But there's times in which that you go to grieving families that have lost children that are younger than them. And they think, how in the world could I ever survive? And you wrap your arms around them and you can just feel the grief permeating off of them. A couple of Octobers ago, I got a phone call late in the night. It was a family member of mine that had veered off the road, but hit somebody head on. And we still are kind of unsure whether or not that he took his own life. We knew that he had been drinking. We knew that there's a lot of questions that come along with his death. And his wife and his grandchildren and his kids are still kind of in the midst of shock and awe and heavy, oppressed grief. They thought all was well. They thought all was good. They didn't know what drove him to that particular decision in his life. You know, sometimes I have people that have asked me the question in my life, to follow God and to have a right relationship with my brothers and sisters in Christ, how far do I got to go? I mean, really, how far do I got to go? We see this image of Jesus. He asks his disciples, "Hey, stay here." And he goes just a little bit further, and then he gets to this place and he tells his other disciples, "Hey, stay here and watch and wait." And Jesus goes just a little bit further. And there's this great, great picture of the God in which that we serve. This Jesus in which that we serve. He might not ever ask us to take the cup in which that he's about to drink. He might not ever ask us to. He will never ask us to take the cup that he was about to drink. But the posture in which that he had to agonize over sure does give us a great example of what we are to do in our relationships with God and our relationship with others. God says, we might ask the question, how far do we really got to go? And in the midst of our counseling, we're talking back and forth, you know, the inclination for me, I'm thinking, you've done everything that you can possibly do. In some scenarios, some cases, the answer is, you've done everything in your power. You've done everything that you could possibly do. In some cases, that is the truth. But in most cases, the answer is, go just a little bit further. How am I to make this relationship right? Just a little bit further. Have I gone far enough? Majority of the time, the answer is, you can go just a little bit further. I think Jesus was there. Being pressed. He's in this place of pressing, and he was literally being pressed in his anxiety and in his sadness. And Jesus gives us this great picture, this lovely picture of the supernatural strength that can only come from the Father. And then go just a little bit further. You see, he's kind of upset with his other disciples that are here that just couldn't stay awake for an hour to come alongside him. And really, he goes further. He comes back. He says, couldn't you just go just a little bit further with me? I mean, couldn't you just stay awake just a little bit? Couldn't you just take that little bit step a little bit further? I know we're talking about a pill that's hard to swallow, even for me today. For Jesus to come to me and say, as far as your efforts are concerned, couldn't you just go just a little bit further? I picture the scene, you know, whenever we're talking about Jesus being agonized, and I've kind of gone past this as it was. CJ, would you mind putting that other picture up there? You guys have seen paintings, you've seen even stained glass pictures of Jesus that this is what the picture looked like. No trees around. I can kind of see a sheep maybe even. It's like he's in a mountainside somewhere. And this is supposed to be a depiction upon Jesus being in the garden. The garden didn't look like this. And really, there was not like a light shining upon him. It wasn't like a moment of great intimacy. intimacy with Jesus at this point in time, I really think that the image looked a little bit like the one that's in your bulletin, the other picture of CJ. I really think that this is what it looked like. Like he's got a kidney stone that just got dislodged. I mean, there's no amount of thing. And I can imagine one, two, three times coming back and praying, maybe getting a little bit of saying, I don't want to do this alone. He has felt completely and utterly alone in this situation. He's having to wrestle with it by himself. He's got some disciples that are outside the garden. He's got some disciples that are close by but haven't gone that far, but he's going a little bit further. And it's as if, I'm not sure if this is really how it happens, but I know what he's wrestling with. Scripture tells us that he's wrestling with this. And here's the case. I believe that as he's in the garden, as he is just prostrate on the floor, and he is agonizing in this place of pressing, being pressed upon him, I can imagine the Father in that moment with Jesus holding up the cup. And it's not as if that Jesus didn't know what the cup was. I believe that without a shadow of a doubt, he knew what it meant to take the cup that he was about to take. He knew what was in that cup. It's the bitterness and the stink and the stench of death that he was going to have to face. He knew that it was going to be a crown of thorns. He knew that he was going to be beaten. He knew that he was going to be hung upon a cross. He knew he was going to have to face death. And that is something that is utterly, he could not even imagine. And not only that, Scripture later on tells us that whenever he was hung on the cross, he says, Father God, why have you forsaken me? It's as if that God literally has taken the presence away from him, and being opposite and away from God is as if he was living on hell on earth. And he said, and the Father says, are you ready to take this cup? And for us to believe that Jesus and his humanity didn't have the choice to say yes or no to this completely misses the point. For us to believe that Jesus didn't have a choice to take this cup or not makes us miss the point completely. I believe that the first, the second time back, and the third time back as he's laying down in the garden praying and the Father is holding out the cup, I believe that there was a point in time, a moment in time, in which that he tightened his jaw and he placed his face like flint. He made the decision and he reaches out his hand and he took it. And there was no struggling from then on out. There was no wrestling match. Was this the right decision or not? I believe that once that he has consecrated that moment and that decision in his heart and in his mind, whenever he said, yes, God, your will be done, not my will be done. You heard him in his statement. If there's any other way that I can do this besides taking this cup, let me know. But if this is your will, let it be so. It is as if his jaw tightened up, and as if, I want you to hear just kind of the posture in which that he takes it from here on out. Verse 45, he says, then he came to his disciples and said to them, will you sleep the rest of the night long? Look, the time has come for the human one to be betrayed to the hands of sinners. Let's get up. You see which direction he's going? He's not taking his disciples. He's not running away. He's not going the opposite direction. He's going right to his betrayer. He's going right to the ones that would arrest him. And you can kind of, if you've been around the church long enough, if you've read the rest of the story, you can see as if that Jesus becomes the selfless, self-giving, sacrificial lamb. A lamb as if that he has become dumb, being led away to be slaughtered. It's not as if that he didn't know what the cup was. not as if he never knew, but he submitted. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he made his mind up. And whenever he did that, he knew what the mission was. And so for you and I, there will never be a point in time in your life that God asks you to take the cup on which he asked Jesus to take. I'm so thankful for that. That Jesus did something for me that you and I could never do for ourselves. And that God would never ask that or require that from us. But there's something that we can learn from this. Maybe today, this sanctuary is your Garden of Gethsemane. Maybe today that you feel like that this sanctuary is a place of pressing. That you bring outside situations in this moment in time in which that it's pressing upon you. And maybe just the decision to follow Christ, to publicly express to somebody, not my will be done. I've been doing it my way this entire time. My cup is not the same cup. It's not the cup of bitterness and the stench of death. Jesus, you've already done that for me. But the decision that I've got to make from here on out is, what am I going to do with that? Now that I know that Jesus has done that for me, now that I knew that Jesus is the one that has paid the price, he is the sacrificial lamb, he's done it all for me, but my life does not reflect that. I've been going the opposite direction, and maybe today is your Garden of Gethsemane in which you have to feel pressed. Maybe the weight of the decision of whether or not this is the day in which that you're going to say, not my will be done, but it's your will. I've been having it my way. Now it's your way, God. And just maybe today, for some people in this room, what is today's date again? March 26th, Watonga, Oklahoma, in 2017. Maybe this is the moment in time in which that you say, hey, this is the date. This is the date in which that I would say, I choose you, your will. And so whenever we gather around a table, we're going to have our ushers, we're going to have them come forward, and we're going to partake in this thing called communion. And it's got some imagery in this table with a cup and some bread. And the truth be told, I think sometimes that whenever we look at this cup, we look at it as if that it's the cup of suffering. Although that it does represent Jesus' blood, the cup of what Jesus offers you is the cup of forgiveness, the cup of everlasting life, and it's your choice to come. That's why that we're setting up three different stations, because there's a willful act. Other moments in time whenever we take communion, our ushers come and they bring it to you. So today we're going to practice something different. It's offered to you. Maybe it's a moment in time, maybe that there's a practice in which that you do, that you set your jaw. You get up out of your seat, and you walk towards the cup of forgiveness. And maybe the cup of forgiveness looks a little bit different than what you ever did before. Maybe for some of you, maybe whenever you take communion, maybe that you don't make your way back to the seats. Maybe you make your way to the altars here. And maybe that there's a moment of decision that you have to make for yourself and say, today is a different day for me. Today is a day in which that I take this cup of forgiveness. And life is never going to look the same again. Maybe Jesus is asking you to go just a little bit further in some of the things that he's been asking you. Maybe for some of the things you're wrestling with, say, I can't go any further. Jesus is ultimately just saying, go just a little bit further. But there's an invitation for us to come. The night that he was betrayed, he took the bread and gave thanks. He says, this is my body, which is broken just for you. his body that was pressed and crushed just for you. In the same way he took the cup, he says, this is the cup of the new covenant. This represents my blood that was spilt just for you. Would you take it and would you be blessed this morning?
Thank you.
Spirit is today, yeah.
I would like to extend an invitation to the people in our congregation to come to our Harvest Church on Thursday. You know, if you're not involved in Celebrate Recovery on Wednesday night or weeping, you know, we grew up in a church where we had a Wednesday night, a midweek service that was like a filling station for the middle of the week. And I invite you to come to Harvest Church, especially people that are so wrapped up in ministering to others in the church. It gives you a chance to step back and be ministered to in the middle of the week. And then you get to go to an amazing service like we had last Thursday. So I invite you to come to Harvest Church on Thursday. It starts at about 6:45. Yes.
47, probably. Hey, we invite you to come back tonight at 6 o'clock. We have good food, we have good fellowship. It's the extreme to which that there's things that we wrestle with. There's things that we go home with on Sunday mornings in which that sometimes, for us, God speaks to us on Sunday mornings. But we go home, there's laundry to be done, and there's lawns to be mowed, and sometimes we forget what happens on Sunday morning. We forget that God has spoken to us. And so Sunday night kind of helps reassure us that, hey, we're not alone in that area. It helps us to realize that, hey, there's other people that wrestle with some of the things that I wrestle with. And so it's just simply a practice and an open invitation for you guys to come and be a part of the community. And I think that happens on Sunday nights as well. Would you go, I know that you're blessed, but would you go in the assurance that God loves you and cares for you so much that he would offer his son, take up a